When one comes to the edge, to the great wall of mountains, the light becomes even more intoxicating. One feels as if he could bound up the side of the mountain in a few giant strides, and then, why then, if one did get to the top? One could race like mad along the smooth spine and jump clear into the sky. One clear headlong flight into the blue and amen forever.
How long you headed, road?
Do you know how to train up right now with all the players in the ball way?
All right, boys, I want to see you on your best game out there, okay? I want to see you fucking sharp as knives. I want to see you on your spit. Have fun.
Where are
you going? Yes, Clarity!
I got 10.
As long as I come out of there with 10, I'm okay.
There is nothing more to conquer. An ocean of peace lay before me. To be free, as I then knew myself to be, is to realize that all conquest is vain. Even the conquest of self, which is the last act of egotism. To be joyous is to carry the ego to its last summit and deliver it triumphantly. To know peace is total. It is the moment after, when the surrender is complete, when there is no longer even the consciousness of surrender. Peace is at the center, and when it is attained, the voice issues forth in praise and benediction. Then the voice carries far and wide, to the outermost limits of the universe. Then it heals, because it brings light and the warmth of compassion.
Down! I think it's really safe to say that Chile is probably our favorite place to play. The first time that we came, we were just shocked by the response that we got. We had played two nights in this arena, and they were sold out. It was just crazy for having never been there before and having no idea that we really had a lot of fans there. It was just an incredible experience for us. So it was sort of easy for us to make a decision to come back to Chile and play. And this trip, it took on a whole new beauty that we hadn't even planned for, based on, you know, some really kind of difficult things that were going on at the time. We had booked the shows in South America, and then the story of the miners who were trapped underground became very big media in the United States. It received a lot of attention, but just so happened that we were already going to Chile to play a concert, so we decided to, you know, spend one of our days off trying to raise money for the families of the miners who'd been trapped underground, because we had recently discovered that they were not being paid for their time underground because supposedly the company that the miners worked for went bankrupt. We just thought we'd utilize the opportunity to do something great for the people of Chile, who had been so great to us, so great to our band. Before we started this trip, our manager, Steve Rennie, did a lot of preemptive work to make sure that any money that we raised would go directly to the families and not get siphoned off. And so he worked with the embassy in Santiago to make sure that all the funds would be treated respectfully, the funds that we raised with the concert, the benefit concert that we played. So when we got down there, actually, Steve and I took a trip to the embassy and met with the ambassador, and it was great to, you know, sort of feel plugged in. There were people eager to help us with our efforts to raise money for the miners. The ambassador had told us this story of how the miners were actually discovered. They were drilling down into what he described as Swiss cheese, and that there was no certainty that they were going to find them at all, that they were blindly just sort of putting these drill bits down way into the ground, like a half mile down. And then one time they put the drill down, when they pulled the drill back up, there was a note attached to it, and it was from the miners that were trapped down there. They said that they were safe, and everybody, you know, obviously kind of freaked out because there was a note attached to a drill bit that had been randomly put down into the earth, and the note had been taken around to different parts of the world and displayed by the president of Chile. It's like a miracle, because it is very miraculous that they found those miners. They would have been gone had it not been for the efforts of the people looking for them. We're all very grateful, and the families, I'm sure, are grateful, and we're just happy that we were able to do anything to help. We decided to play a benefit concert for the miners, and we sat down to try and figure out something that would make the concert unique. The idea came up of finding a youth orchestra, writing some new arrangements for the orchestra to play along with the band. Everybody seemed enthusiastic about the idea. I actually consulted with one of my professors at Harvard, a very wonderful German music scholar named Matthias Roda. He reached out and found a bit of a pickup orchestra. We found a great conductor named Carlos Figueroa. I wrote most of the string arrangements actually on the plane on the way down there. So it was very uncertain how it would turn out, because stuff like that, you never really know until you're actually hearing the music. And Carlos was just awesome. He had this really fantastic energy, and he actually was very familiar with a lot of our music ahead of time. So when we got to work together, it was just perfect. So we got there, we had to plan some rehearsals with the orchestra, and we were under the impression that it was going to be in a rehearsal studio, but when we got there, it was actually a recording studio. We got to spend a day with an orchestra, and then, you know, sort of the later half of the day just kind of messing around, because we had the studio time. We spent the first half of the day running through the four songs that we played with the orchestra, one of which was Runaway Train, which was one of Brandon's songs from his solo record, The Wild Trapeze, which was actually, it was not his idea that we play that song. I actually just thought it would be something kind of fun and kind of cool, and he was, of course, pretty shy about it. It was really fun. It was a lot of fun. It was like, you know, Brandon let me sort of take his baby and put some new clothes on it, which was courageous of him, and I think it came out really well, and I think he was really happy with it. But you know, it was really great to work on a song like that, because you know, it was his own piece of music that he wrote from the ground up. You know, he wrote all of the music and wrote all the parts and you know, basically produced it all himself, and then he kind of allowed me to grapple with it a little bit. It was just a lot of fun. It was great.
I made a little record this past year, and we're gonna play a song from it right now.
We were sort of staring at a second half of a day's time in a studio, and we had nothing to do. So Ben actually brought up the idea of us recording a Rolling Stones cover to give to our manager, Steve, as a present. We just thought that it would make his head explode, and it did. We played Painted Black. Don't know if we did the song justice, but it was really fun. We had a great time, and that's all that matters.
I see a red door and I want it painted blue. No colors anymore, I want them to turn blue. I see the girls walk by dressed in their summer clothes. I had to turn my head. never to forget. I see people turn their heads and quickly look away. Like a newborn baby, it just happens every day. I look inside myself and see my heart is bled. I see my red door and I must have it painted black. Maybe then I'll fade away and not have to face the facts. Not easy facing up when your whole world is black. No more will my green seagull turn a deeper blue. I could not for this thing happening to you. If I let her ride and up into the setting sun, anymore, I want them to blend. I see the girls go by just in their summer clothes. I had to turn my head until my darkness closed.
Us in the band were very, very, very excited when just the prospect of coming back to Chile and to these places in South America we're visiting presented themselves again, because coming to Chile in particular, it's probably the most enthusiastic and welcoming crowd that we could ever come back to, and it almost makes it it doesn't feel like we're on tour. It feels like we're like guests here, and we're being held the cradling arms of the, you know, the kids from Chile. And it's a totally different feeling than any other place we've played. In a nutshell, it's really nice and it's really enjoyable to come to places and make music where they really, really want you. Different cultures have different ways of expressing that. You know, some people sing, some people cheer, and it's all really cool and really interesting and really flattering and scary and all of these. This is, you run the gamut of the emotions. But we come to Chile and like people are at the airport when we get there. It's almost like they're your extended family and you haven't seen them in years. They're like, welcome back! You know, there's signs and they're at the hotel like all day and they're in the lobby and they're out front. And it's almost intimidating a little bit, but it's less intimidating this time because we've done it once before. And now it's just kind of fun. So like with the show that we did, I don't really think the guys were nervous about playing like we normally would be, a little bit, have some nerves and stuff like that. I didn't feel that way. I didn't feel nervous to play the show. I just felt like, I felt like this is where we're supposed to be. So nothing really to be nervous about, you know. We know how to do what we do and we've come to do it, and everyone's been, you know, playing really great and enjoying themselves. So it's kind of awesome. I hope we get to come back sometime soon.
Is there anyone?